Our dear students, today we are going to start the second chapter of our subject, that is design of dosage regimen. And the very first topic over here is nomograms and tabulations in designing dosage regimen. So over here we'll be studying about nomograms and tabulation and how we can utilize nomograms and tabulation in the designing of dosage regimen. So we will split these things. First of all, we'll understand about dosage regimen and then we will move to nomograms and tabulations and how we can apply these two things in designing a dosage regimen. So first of all, dose. What is a dose? Dose is nothing but it is the quantity of medicine to be taken or recommended to be taken at a particular time. So that is dose. Secondly, what is meant by dosage? Dosage is nothing but it is the size of the dose, or you can say frequency, by which the medication has to be taken. Like for example, 1 spoonful of drug to be taken 3 times a day, or that particular drug not to be exceeded beyond the recommended dose. So that is dosage. And lastly, what is meant by dosage regimen? So regimen over here is, it is the schedule of doses of the therapeutic agent per unit time, including the time between doses. Like for example, every 6 hours the drug has to be taken, or the time when the dose are to be given. For example, at 8 a.m. and at 4 p.m. daily the dose has to be taken. And it also includes the amount of medicines, like number of capsules to be given at each specified time. Or in short and sweet method, you can say dosage regimen means it is the manner in which a drug is to be taken. Just assume, for example, if you are suffering from headache, so what you will do? At night you will consume 1 paracetamol tablet and the next day morning you will get up healthy and fresh. But there are certain illness, like any bacterial infection is there, then the doctor will prescribe you a complete course of nearly 3 to 5 days. Okay, so you need to take antibiotics for 3 days or for 5 days. So you need to consume it for every 5 days. And why you need to consume it for 5 days? So because we need to maintain a constant plasma level of that particular drugs. Okay, so means there are under certain circumstances, drugs has to be taken on a repetitive basis over a period of time, depending upon the nature of illness. Okay, like antibiotics only, you need to take it 5 times. Okay, a course of 5 times, and daily you need to take 2 tablets. Or in some cases, 3 tablets. So we can understand this thing with a graph. Suppose on the x-axis, obviously it is for a dose, and on the y-axis, obviously for the response. And 2 important lines, this blue line and violet line is very much important. The action of the drug should be in between this blue line and the violet line. Okay, if the dose exceeds the violet line, that means that the drug is likely to produce some adverse effect. And if the dose is below the blue line, that means that no action of the drug will be produced. Okay, so every time the therapeutic window, it is known as, so the activity of a drug should be always in between this blue line and violet line. Okay, suppose you gave an initial dose. Okay, first of all it increases and then it moves to the therapeutic window where the activity of the drug will be there, where the actually the required plasma concentration of the drug will be achieved, and slowly the drug will get eliminated off. Okay, so before the drug is eliminated out, a second dose of the drug is being given so that the plasma concentration of the drug will be always in the required level. When the second dose is about to eliminate, before it moves to the blue line, a third dose of the drug has to be taken. Okay, so this is how we are giving multiple dosage regimen, means this is dosage regimen, you can say, so that every time the drug should be maintained at a plasma concentration, at an appropriate plasma concentration, you can say. Okay, so in this case, such kind of designing of dosage regimen is to be done. So once parameters like total clearance, volume of distribution and elimination half-life has been determined, and a relation between free or total drug serum concentration and pharmacological response has been established, a dosage regimen based on the pharmacokinetic parameters can be developed. So usually the main objective of the dosage regimen, yes, it is to maintain an average steady state concentration. Okay, so an optimal multiple dosage regimen is the one in which drug is administered in suitable doses with sufficient frequency that ensures maintenance of the plasma concentration within the therapeutic window for the entire duration of the therapy. Okay. Next, there are certain approaches for designing the dosage regimen. So various approaches employed in the designing of the dosage regimens are, first of all, empirical dosage regimen, second one is the individual dosage regimen, and thirdly, there is dosage regimen based on population average. So we'll check out these one by one. So first of all, coming to the empirical dosage regimen, in many cases, physician selects a dosage regimen of the patient without using any pharmacokinetic variables. So the physician makes the decision based on the empirical clinical data, personal experience, and the clinical observation. Anyways, this method, however, is not very accurate. Okay. Next is the individual dosage regimen. It is the most accurate approach and is based on the pharmacokinetics of the drug in the individual patient. The approach is suitable for hospitalized patients but is quite expensive. So this is most accurate approach. Dose calculation is based on the pharmacokinetics of the drug in the individual patient derived from the measurement of the plasma concentration of the drug. And the last and the third most approach is the dosage regimen based on population average. So the dosage regimen is calculated based on average pharmacokinetic parameters from clinical studies published in the drug literature. Like for instance, population data indicates that there is a significant relationship between the clearance of digoxin and creatinine clearance. As creatinine clearance decreases, so does the clearance of digoxins. So the reported population-based relationship for digoxin can be used to estimate a clearance value in an individual patient based on their creatinine clearance. Moreover, this method is based on one of the two models. The first model is fixed and the second one is adaptive. Okay, see, this thing is like very much similar to what you do online shopping. Like whenever you want to purchase anything online, you will check out the reviews, and depending on the reviews, you will think that whether I should buy that thing or not. It is almost similar to that thing. Okay, now we'll check out the two models. First of all, we'll check out the fixed model. Here, population average pharmacokinetic parameters are used directly to calculate the dosage regimen. So basically, it assumes that population average pharmacokinetic parameters may be used directly to calculate a dosage regimen for the patient without any alteration. The practitioner may use the usual dosage suggested by the literature and then make a small adjustment of the dosage based on the patient's age and weight. Usually, pharmacokinetic parameters such as absorption rate, bioavailability, volume of distribution, and elimination rate are assumed to remain constant, and most often drug is assumed to follow one compartment model. But when a multiple dose regimen is designed, multiple dosage equations based on the principle of superposition are used to evaluate the dose. So this is about the fixed model. Second one is the adaptive model. So this adaptive model is based on both population average pharmacokinetic parameters of the drug as well as patient variables such as age, sex, body surface area, and known patient's pathophysiological conditions like renal disease. So this approach attempts to adapt or modify the dosage regimen according to the need of the patient. It basically uses patients' variables such as their weight, age, sex, body surface area, and known patients' pathophysiological conditions like renal disease or hepatic disease or metabolic disease and so on and so forth, as well as known population average pharmacokinetic parameters of the drug. So this model generally assumes that pharmacokinetic parameters such as drug clearance do not change from one dose to the next. However, some adaptive models allow for continuously adaptive change with time in order to simulate more closely the changing process of the drug disposition in the patients, especially during a diseased condition. Okay, so these are the various approaches to be done when designing a dosage regimen. Next, we'll check out what exactly is this nomogram. So nomogram in Greek, it is derived from a Greek word where nomos means law and gram means line. So by definition, it is a graphical calculating device, a two-dimensional diagram designed to allow the approximate graphical computation of the mathematical functions. Okay, so we calculate it with the help of three lines. In this, the outside two lines contains the known parameters, whereas the middle line contains the unknown parameter. So what this is, you will get to know with the help of this simple example. Now suppose there is an example, like an infant is 45 centimeter tall and weighs 2.5 kg. Then what is the infant's BSA? BSA is body surface area. So for calculating body surface area, we have got a nomogram which is somewhat like this. Okay, here you can see there is a scale for height. Over here there is a scale for weight. And at the center there is a scale for body surface area. So this is a nomogram. Nomogram contains three lines. The outer two lines contains the known parameters, whereas the centermost line contains the unknown parameter. Now you can see in the height, two options are given. Like we can calculate the height in centimeters, and we can also calculate the height. There is a separate scale for feet and inches. Similarly for weights also, we have got a scale for kilogram and a scale for pounds also. Now we will calculate the body surface area of this infant. In the question, few known parameters are given, like the height of the infant is 45 centimeter. So in the height scale, just check out where is 45 centimeter. In the centimeter scale, we should find, and yes, here it is the 45 centimeter. Next, the weight is 2.5 kg. Now go to the scale of the weight. On the one side there is pound, on another side, on the right side, we can find the kilogram. So on the kilogram side, you select the 2.5 kg, like here is 2, here is 3, and at the center you will find 2.5. Next, what you need to do, we should connect a line like this. Okay, 45 height centimeter, 2.5 kg weight, you should connect the line, and you should see where the line intersect to the scale of the body surface area. Like on the body surface area, the most lowest digit is 0.1 and above it is 0.2. So you can count 0.1, above it is 0.11, 0.12, 0.13, 0.14, 0.15, the bigger line, 0.16 and 0.17. Okay, so we'll get body surface area 0.17 and the unit is meter square. So 0.17 meter square we found with the help of the nomogram, and you saw this is so much simple. Just we should connect the known parameter line, and at the center the unknown parameter scale will be there, and wherever it intersects, that will be the result. So according to this nomogram, we got the body surface area to be 0.17 meter square. So for calculating body surface area, we have got equations also, that BSA, body surface area, is equals to square root of height in centimeter into weight in kg divided by 3600. We'll cross check with this formula. So height is 45 into 2.5 divided by 3600 is equals to so much value we got, and finally square root of 0.03125, we got 0.17 meter square. Okay, so you compare these things, results are same, but which method was very much simple? See, for calculating body surface area by using this equation, you should take out your calculator and you should calculate. But with the help of nomograms, just you drew a line and you got the result. So this is the benefit of nomograms. Okay. Next, applications of nomograms in pharmacokinetic studies. So population based nomograms have been recommended for initial dosing of most drugs currently subjected to therapeutic drug monitoring, including aminoglycosides, decoxins and thiophilines, which have got very narrow therapeutic index. In order to keep dosage regimen calculation simple, complicated equations are often solved. The result displayed diagrammatically on special scaled axes to produce a simple dose recommendation based on patient information. Some nomograms make use of certain physiological parameters such as serum creatinine concentration to help modify the dosage regimen according to renal function. For many marketed drugs, the manufacturer provides tabulated general guidelines for use in establishing a dosage regimen for patients, including the loading dose and the maintenance dose. Nomogram is a predictive tool. They provide individual predictions based on characteristics of one single patient. The predictions are derived from hundreds or even thousands of patients who presented the same condition. Individual prediction represents one of the advantages of nomograms relative to risk groupings of patients population who share similar disease characteristics. Okay, so you can create a result depending upon the individual result or a population. Like in few population of people, you gave certain kind of drug and you found the result this much. So depending upon those population, a dosage regimen can be plotted with the help of the nomogram. So these are the various applications of nomogram in pharmacokinetic studies. Next, we'll take one sample example. Okay, and we will check how we can utilize this nomogram in the calculation. Okay, so one case we'll take. Here, Meena is a 50-year-old female who has been diagnosed with pneumonia secondary to Pseudomonas aeruginosa. The provider would like to add tobramycin to Meena's current regimen. Actual body weight of Meena is 70 kg and Meena's height is 67 inches. Ideal body weight for this drug, that is tobramycin, is 61.6 kg. Meena's serum creatinine level is 0.9 mg per deciliter and Pseudomonas MIC for tobramycin is 1 microgram per ml. Okay, so this is the case given, and we will now select a dosage regimen with the help of a nomogram. So step 1, determine which body weight to be chosen. Like we have got Meena's body weight, that is 70 kg, and we have got ideal body weight of 61.6 kg. But the actual body weight of Meena is not 1.2 times greater than the actual body weight. Okay, so there is not much difference in the actual body weight and the ideal body weight. So in this case, we can use Meena's actual body weight, that is 70 kg. Next, step 2, calculation of dose. The dose of tobramycin, the standard dose of tobramycin is 7 mg per kg. Now the weight is 70. So 7 mg per kg into 70 kg. So we'll get 490 mg. Okay, obviously kg gets cancelled off and our dose will be 490 mg. Okay, so dose we have calculated. We need to calculate. Means once we have calculated how much amount of drug is to be given, next we need to calculate at what frequency we need to give this dose. Okay, so step number 3, draw tobramycin level 6 to 14 hours after dose given. Level drawn after 10 hours comes back at 6 microgram per ml. This is the founding we got. So utilize Hartford nomogram to determine dosing interval. Okay, so this is Hartford nomogram. And what observation we got, you can see in step 3, we need to draw tobramycin level 6 to 14 hours. Okay, so here you can see on the x-axis, time from start of infusion of the drug. And we have started it from 6 hours. Okay, this is a standard. This is a standard Hartford nomogram and you need to plot it in this manner only. And from finding we got, at 10 hours, the level of the plasma concentration of tobramycin was found to be 6 microgram per ml. Okay, so at 10 hours, It was found to be 6 microgram per ml. Now you can see the point of dissection has been come on the yellow strip where Q36 is written. Q36 means Q36 hours, means the amount of dose of tobramycin has to be given at an interval of 36 hours. So this is what shows the Hartford nomogram. So for tobramycin, it is an aminoglycoside with a very narrow index, with a very narrow therapeutic index. And usually for dosing of this tobramycin, we are following Hartford nomogram, which is in this manner. Suppose the intersection comes in green line, means we need to give the tobramycin dosing for every 24 hours. If the intersection comes at the red strips, at the red band, that implies that we need to give the tobramycin for every 48 hours. Now in our case, it has come to yellow strip, Q36 strip. That means we need to give the dosing frequency or the dosage regimen should be like for every 36 hours that tobramycin dose has to be given. Okay. Next, if you see carefully, in this list, one more important thing is given, that is serum creatinine level, which is 0.9 mg per deciliter. This is very much important. So from serum creatinine level, we can check out how frequently the this tobramycin is getting eliminated. See, elimination of this tobramycin takes via the renal, okay? And as the creatinine elimination increases, the tobramycin elimination also increases. So for this also, we have got a nomogram somewhat like this, and the name of this nomogram is Sitzbach-Nenzel nomogram. So here you can see on the left side, clearance ml per minute. So this is for creatinine clearance. Beside that, weight is given in kg. Beside that, at the center, one line is there where R is written. Beside, more right to that, you can see age in years. Here two columns are there. One column is for males and another column is for female. And more beyond, you can see serum creatinine mg per 100 ml or mg per deciliter. Okay. Now we know many known factors are there. Just we need to check out the creatinine clearance. And accordingly, we can calculate the tobramycin clearance. So by getting the creatinine clearance value, we can understand how frequently the tobramycin is getting eliminated or cleared off from our body. Now, what all known parameters we have? Like, we have got age. Meena's age is 50. So on the age, you can see on the left side is for male, on the right side is for female. So sum here, you will get the 50 years. Next, weight we have, that is 70 kg. So in the weight line, we should check out where is 70, somewhere here. Now we should draw a line. We should connect the age with weight. Next, we have the value for serum creatinine level, that is 0.9 mg per deciliter, which is somewhere over here. Now we should draw a line from this serum creatinine level up to the clearance, and that should intersect the previous line at the R line. So that will give the creatinine clearance in ml per minute. So here we got 80 ml per minute is the creatinine clearance, and so will be the clearance of the tobramycin. Okay. So in this manner, we can utilize nomogram for dosage regimen and how frequently we should give the dosing and how it is getting eliminated. All information, these all pharmacokinetic information we are getting from the nomograms. Next, we should check out few advantages and disadvantages of nomograms. First, we'll check out the advantages. It is a very low cost, just paper and ink is required. Next, very easy to use, especially for inexperienced practitioners. Obviously, the doctors who are very much old age, they can give the dosing very easily because they have got that much of experience. But any new doctor, they don't have that much experience. So this nomogram will be quite helpful for them. Next, no power required. Very complex equations are easily solved. Lastly, it is very fast to use. Next, we'll check out the disadvantages. They tend to wear out. Obviously, with population, sometimes changes in the drug response may change with time. So we cannot rely on the previous history. Next, may be difficult to create. Limited accuracy. And lastly, highly specialized to few equations. So these are all advantages and disadvantages of nomograms. Next we'll go to tabulations. So tabulation means it is to tabulate information, is to organize it into a table. Tabulating is a way of processing information or data by putting it in a table. This doesn't mean the kind of table you eat off of, though it refers to a table or chart with rows and columns. Okay, so for many marketed drugs, the manufacturer provides tabulated general guidelines for use in establishing a dosage regimen for patients, including the loading dose and maintenance dose. Okay, like for drugs with narrow therapeutic range such as thiophylline, a guide for monitoring serum drug concentration is to be given. Okay, and another example is the aminoglycoside antibiotic, that is tobramycin, which is eliminated primarily by renal clearance. Thus, the dosage of tobramycin sulfate should be reduced in direct proportional to the reduction in the creatinine clearance, which we can see right over here. So the manufacturer provides nomogram for establishing the percent of the normal dose of tobramycin sulfate, assuming the serum creatinine level has been obtained. Okay, so these are the various applications of nomograms and tabulation in designing the dosage regimen. I hope you people understood this video. Thank you for watching.